Hello, my name is Howard Lake from UK Fundraising, and today I'm delighted to be talking to Beth Crackles about fundraising apprenticeships. Hi Beth, how are you?
Hello Howard, I'm well, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Tell me, what you've been working over the last few months on a new fundraising apprenticeship scheme. Tell us about that.
Sure, yes. So for the past sort of 4 to 5 months, I've been working with the JGA Group, which is one of the larger training providers, on developing the curriculum for the fundraiser apprenticeship. And an apprenticeship is essentially professional training that is around specific knowledge, behaviours and skills that have been identified by a trailblazer group, which included organisations like Teenage Cancer Trust, Children's Society, etc., etc., all the biggies. And the apprenticeship standard was approved last year, and so a handful of different training providers have been developing their curriculum. So that's what I've been supporting the JGA group with. In practical terms, an apprenticeship means that you have a job, you work, and 20% of that time that you would usually spend on the job is off the job doing the apprenticeship. So essentially you work 4 days a week and the fifth day you do your apprenticeship learning.
And who's it for? Is it for any charity or any individual?
Yeah, it is. It's open to everybody, regardless of age or background, whether they are already working within a fundraising role or within the charity sector, or whether they're coming from a different sector and moving across. You just have to need the training, i.e. you can't already be above the level of the apprenticeship, which is level 3. So I think that's equivalent to a level standard.
Okay. And I believe it's also available for furloughed fundraisers as well.
Yes, it is. Yeah, good point. Yeah.
So tell me, how is it assessed? How do we know the quality of this?
Sure. So the assessment, there are two elements to the assessment. The first is a case for support pitch and presentation, which essentially means that you need to be able to deliver a presentation to a specific audience that you agree with your employer and your skills coach, and that you're able to provide the rationale behind why you have developed the presentation, the case for support in that particular way. So in that you will draw on previous modules around supporter insight, motivations, behavior, communication style, creating winning communications, etc. And then the second piece is a professional discussion. And this is informed by a portfolio of evidence that the learners will create throughout the duration of the apprenticeship. And that portfolio will be provided to the Endpoint Assessment Organisation, as they're known. It's the Chartered Institute of Fundraising. The portfolio itself isn't assessed, but it informs what the sort of questions are around that discussion.
I was going to ask about the Chartered Institute of Fundraising's involvement or link with this. How does this apprenticeship fit or align with the Institute's focus and activities?
Sure. So the Chartered Institute of Fundraising has their existing fundraising certificate, which is a level 4 qualification. And the apprenticeship is level 3. So what the I want to call it the IOF all the time. The Chartered Institute of Fundraising has created another award, which is a level 3 award, which is called the Foundation Certificate. So everybody who passes the apprenticeship will get that Foundation Certificate. So it could be seen as a precursor to the fundraising certificate itself. So it aligns nicely with their program around CPD. The second thing to note is that the Chartered Institute of Fundraising is the Endpoint Assessment Organisation. So they will be the ones coming in and assessing the learners at the end. They've obviously been involved with the development of it as well, and are clearly very supportive of it too.
That's good. How do the finances work? Who pays?
So there are a number of financial incentives that I would recommend each organisation to look into themselves, because I'm not one to be giving financial advice. Larger organisations, so typically if your salary bill is over around 3 million, you will be paying into an apprenticeship levy. So you will be able to use that levy to fund the apprenticeship. If you don't use it, it basically goes into a government pot. If you are a non-levy paying organisation, there are a couple of options. One is that I think you pay around 5% of the training fee, and the government will provide the remaining 95%. The other option, which I'm exploring for a charity I'm currently working with, is the potential for levy paying organisations to transfer that. It's known as levy transfer. So I'm having a conversation with a LEP, a local enterprise partnership in Yorkshire, about that later this week. So there are a few different options.
Yeah. Okay. And you've been working with the JGA Group on this. Do you want to tell us what we should know about the group?
Yeah, sure. The JGA Group is essentially a family-run business, although it's one of the largest training providers, so there is a good staff team behind it. It delivers various different apprenticeships around marketing and communications, digital, etc., etc. So the shift into fundraising apprenticeship is a natural one. Last year, it was named as the training provider of the year at the BAME Apprenticeship Awards, which I'm really, really pleased that has happened, that I'm working with them, particularly given the push and progression around EDI in the charity sector. And I guess in terms of the JGA apprenticeship, other training providers are available. The things that I think potentially set it apart are things like we have some really cool guest speakers lined up. So Louise Morris from Summit Fundraising, Vanessa Longley from Young Minds, Jamie Ward-Smith, who's chair of the Cooperative Foundation and chief exec at Do It Foundation. So we're bringing in these amazing people to provide real experiences and give that breadth and depth of the sector. The other thing which I'm really thrilled about is that the final module is around developing an integrated campaign, and it's going to be what we're calling a simulated experience, which basically means that you're going to be working from concept to delivery, creating the creative brief, and then pitching to a charity in real life. So you get that real life experience, really.
Okay, so if anyone's interested in this, either as an individual or an organisation, what do they do next?
Sure, so there are a couple of criteria that people need to be aware of. First of all, learners need to be employed by the organisation. Secondly, the employer needs to be committed to this. So they do need to be providing support around the apprenticeship. And the third thing is that the learners do actually need to have the training. I think I've already mentioned this, they can't already be working above it. And JGA do a skills audit to help people identify where they're at. So the next step is, if you think this is something that would be good for you or good for your organisation, then I would recommend that you get in touch with the JGA Group. I just want to mention a couple of other things, if I may, which is around the structure of the apprenticeship. It is 14 months long. The JGA version is 14 months long. It's 10 modules, which are topped and tailed by an introductory session where you get to know the tutor, you're introduced to your skills coach, you get a sense of the different modules and how you're expected to engage with them. And then the final module is around endpoint assessment preparation. And so that's essentially looking at where sort of strengths and weaknesses of learners are, and it will be tailored to them to support them to get a pass, and for those who are seeking it, to stretch them to distinction as well.
Beth Crackles, thank you very much indeed.
Thanks so much, Howard.